Okay, so it seems we have to start. So it's
Good.
time.
I will start then.
So hello to everybody once again, and let's start our evening session. And the first speaker is Augustas Aniotis. The title of his talk, String Instability Issues with the Broken Supersymmetry. Please, Augustas.
Thank you very much. Let me start by thanking Misha and Ruslan for the nice invitation. And let me add a comment. People have complained that we cannot travel, which is certainly a true fact. But this is arguably my fastest trip to Moscow ever. And more seriously, continuing to broadcast online seminars and conferences can be a fantastic opportunity for many people. So even if and when we get out of this mess, we should not forget this. No, now, so let me start my presentation. This is very well known to everyone, right? You know, we have this famous hexagon in 10 dimensions. Many people contributed to it, but there is one name that stands out, and this is Witten. And this hexagon comprises some sides where I put black arrows, because those sides are guaranteed by perturbative string theory. If you look at it closely and attentively, one way or another, you will get the link between type 2a and type 2b, hetrodic and the two hetrodics, and the orientable projection. However, there are some other links in red here, which not only are not guaranteed by the worksheet formulation of string theory, but they are like just beyond it. And they were actually suggested by the Lorentz supergravity, which behaved in some sense as a chiral model of string theory. Now, what is less known and less appreciated, that there is a lot of life beyond this diagram. And the issue is when what happens if you allow broken supersymmetry. And if you allow broken supersymmetry, see what you get. You get a much wider diagram, which looks like a complicated molecule in the way I depicted it. But lo and behold, there are extra options when you go beyond these six sides, and you can do it in two different ways. By performing some orbifolds of the original 10-dimensional supersymmetric models, or performing some orientifolds thereof when it's possible. The orientifolds are in green and the orbifolds are in black. But what happens is that you get a wide number of theories which are without supersymmetry, and they contain tachyons in their spectrum, plus three special theories, one of hetrodic type, and hence obtained by an orbifold projection, and two of the obtained by orientifold projections, where supersymmetry is absent, or rather, to be more precise, it's absent in two of them, this one and this one, and it's non-linearly realized in the third, which in my opinion is one of the biggest puzzles of string theory, on the par with the puzzle that the string theory itself is related to something in lower dimension which has nothing to do with strings. The reason is that we are used to considering nonlinear symmetries as limits of linear symmetries when some fields are falling out of the spectrum. But lo and behold, what happens? What happens is that these three special theories manifest themselves by the appearance in the Lorentz effective field theory, which is a gravity coupled to certain gauge fields or forms. The appearance in this theory of a tadpole potential, I'll call it a tadpole potential. Here I actually displayed it in the string frame and limited it to the case of the orientifolds. I will comment now also on the other case. First, the orientifold, and in particular the orientifold, which has this very strange phenomenon of brain supersymmetry breaking. Explaining it in pictorial terms is easy, because what one does, one replaces one type of orientifold that the theory allows with negative tension and negative charge with another orientifold which remains BPS but has reverted signs for both. So the tension is always equal to the charge, but they're both positive. And in order to absorb the charge of this object, one needs anti-brains. So, in other words, in the vacuum, there are objects which preserve different portions of supersymmetry which are incompatible, and altogether, supersymmetry is broken. Now, What happens in these systems is that since the theoretical is not a dynamical object, all it does is an unpairing, which you can see in this cartoon on the right hand side here, between Bose and Fermi modes, but no tachyons can be generated. Tachyons are the sign of attractions of certain extended objects, and they cannot be a physical attraction in this case, in the sense that this object is bound to be at the end of space-time, so to speak. Now this potential appears again, and now we are here is the beginning of our problem. We have this vacuum energy. I call it vacuum energy. Actually, it's the vacuum energy, the name is more appropriate to the heterotic theory, where there would be no power of e to the minus phi here, and the phenomenon would essentially originate from the torus amplitude. Here it's essentially a three-level phenomenon due to the presence of the brains. But the problem is that lo and behold, what I'm trying to describe for you is what we can extract from this kind of setting. And it looks very complicated, because in string theory, as we know it today, all we can do is a double expansion in powers of alpha prime r and in powers of the string tension. So this appears very complicated, because insofar as this term satisfies these two requirements, we can be quantitative in string theory itself. When these conditions are not fulfilled, and most of the time will not be fulfilled, then we solve well-defined problems for Einstein gravity coupled to matter, but the relevance for string theory becomes a little bit less evident. So let me start with vacuum solutions. Now, vacuum solutions have been studied in three different contexts, if you want, in three classes. The first one is cosmological solutions. The second one is, I could call it symmetric solutions. And the other one is non-symmetric solutions. The study of cosmological solutions and non-symmetric solutions originate from a paper of Dudas and Murad at the end of the 90s. And in the cosmological case, there was an addition, another paper of Russo, that studied the behavior of these systems as gamma, if you want, is varied, and followed by an observation in this paper with Emilian Dudas and Kitazawa, in which we understood pictorially that a real transition was taking place. Briefly stated, in this case, there are two classes of solutions, which would be the independent solutions if the potential were flat. The scalar could emerge from the initial singularity from the left or from the right. Here, if it does, there is a big difference, because if it emerges from the right, it's descending the potential. And if it emerges from the left, it climbs the potential. And after some climbing, it's bound to return, to go back, because that just doesn't have enough energy to go further. In string theory, it makes a big difference, because this former option, the climbing solution, is a weak coupling solution. So we are half the way toward believing what we are doing in this approach. And I don't have to convince you that we don't have the tools in string theory to tackle this problem in a full-fledged context. So, and what is the interest here? The interest is that remarkably, the string theories lie in this critical regime. Gamma is equal to 3/2 for the orientifolds, and it's equal to 5/2 for the heterotic string. Now, you may question a little bit what one is doing for the heterotic string, because one is mixing a three-level action with the first quantum corrections. My answer to that is, it's not the first time we do it. The Green-Schwarz mechanism does it. And in any case, this term in the weak coupling regime is the dominant one. But lo and behold, we have this fact. Now, the interesting fact is the following, that if the scalar climbs, it basically packs up some energy, and then it can release it. If it releases the energy, then what can it do? Well, if the potential is accompanied by other milder contributions, which of course we cannot get from a top-down perspective, then this is a natural mechanism to start inflation. And what happens in this case? What happens is that there is a fast slow roll transition, and this fast slow roll transition depresses the power spectrum of scalar, actually tensor fluctuations. So there is some information here that was not guaranteed at all. Now, the second type of solution, non-symmetric solution. Here there is another remarkable fact. We are all used to Kaluza-Klein, compactification. In Kaluza-Klein compactification, you take a circle, and then what happens is that the size of the circle is a modulus. It's completely undetermined by the theory. Here the situation is different. You have this tuple potential, and now you can find compactification where the tuple potential, so to speak, is completely eaten up in the hidden compact dimensions. The theory ends up in flat space-time, ends up there with the gravity well activated, which means with a finite Planck mass. And the size of the interval now is completely determined in proper units of the inverse of the square tension, of this tension, sorry, square root of tension. Now, this vacuum is so important. In this section, I will call it the Dudas-Murat vacuum. There is actually a generalization of this Dudas-Murat vacuum for different values of gamma, but the behavior is similar. So here's the good parts of the story, no? Spontaneous compactification, finite nine-dimensional Planck mass, and actually even gauge couplings, because you can also compute that. The problem is that this solution is a well-defined solution of Einstein's theory, but it has two problematic regions. The string coupling diverges at one end, and the curvature diverges at the other. The interesting fact about the solution, and I kindly ask you to keep it in mind, is that the solution is not symmetric. Now the questions that I will try to address. How do Fermi fields behave in this context? And the other question is string corrections in general. Is a large string coupling needed for these types of compactification? And the next question is the issue of stability. So now I'll show you another solution that seems to be absolutely ideal. It's absolutely ideal, the solution, because it's symmetric. It's one of these ADS times S spaces that are studied for many different reasons. And actually, here I forgot, I made a mistake. There is another previous work of Gubser and Mitra that found one of these cases. We discovered it at some point when we were doing this investigation. I should have added it, and it's not here. Now, these solutions are ADS cross S, and what is interesting is that playing with the parameters, if you want, essentially with the flux, you can make both the string coupling small and the radius large. So in other words, these solutions are completely within the perturbative realm of string theory. So let's see what happens if one studies the stability of these systems. First of all, the ones that looked most promising, and they are not actually, they are not for a conceptual reason that will become clear later on. So this oriented folds with symmetric background, ADS cross S, if you want, there are non-supersymmetric versions of the ADS cross S spaces that you are used to deal with. The lack of supersymmetry being a consequence of the presence of the tuple potential that needs to be absorbed, so to speak. Now there are violations of the Prandtl and Friedmann bounds for modes with internal excitations. So the key mechanism that creates this problem is the mixing between different types of modes that gets to be present when Kaluza-Klein excitations are considered. In this case, they are associated to angular momentum eigenstates, if you want, Laplace operator eigenstates in the internal space. There is a puzzle still, or at least if you want a curiosity. This schematically, I represented here the point in this parameter space, which is essentially related to the fluxes, the radii and all this stuff. The actual point that characterizes these two parameters, never mind the precise definition, for this theory, and the region of stability. The region of stability is the one where this surface overcomes this negative, display with negative vertical coordinate, which represents the Breitenone-Friedmann bound. I remind you that in ADS, the problem does not present itself with scalar instabilities at zero mass squared. The issue is not tangents, but the issue is scalar excitations which have a squared mass below a certain bound that depends on the spin. This is called the Breitenone-Friedmann bound. So you see that essentially this point, course, the what I'm telling you is merely qualitative because I don't have a measure to sell you the story, but it's very, very close to the stable region. And now here comes the surprise. If we analyze the Dudas-Murad Bakya, they're all stable. And the computation starts to be much more complicated here. The reason is that these vacua are not symmetric. Although the dependence is on a single coordinate, you have to study, like in the previous case, perturbations, if you want, organizing them in multiplets, which correspond to the residual symmetries. In this case, I'm displaying you an example. The example is scalar perturbations. There is a scalar field, A, which deforms the space-time metric and the internal metric. This is the metric corresponding to the compactness internal, this interval. Now, this scalar field satisfies a complicated equation because omega is one of these Gaussian functions and various things that I showed you before. Phi is the actual solution for the dilaton that I showed you, and d of phi is the derivative of the potential computed on that solution. So it's a very non-trivial differential equation. It's linear, of course, because I'm studying linear perturbations, but it has all the complications it can have. However, there is a beautiful trick here that I learned from Jihad Murad. And it has a wide applicability, but in retrospect, it permeates many areas of mathematics and physics. And the point is the following. You will recognize behind the corner, if you want, index theorems, supersymmetry in quantum mechanics and the next. But to make the long story short, what happens is that you can define a differential operator, ddr minus a certain alpha of r, and you can recast the differential equation in the following form. You see that this is effectively after redefining the field A, that's why I called it psi, becomes a Schrödinger-like equation. But not only Schrödinger-like equation where part of the Schrödinger operator is manifestly positive. And the remainder is the question. If it's zero, then you are done. If it's positive, you are done. If it's negative, then you have to be more precise, more detailed in your investigation. Now, in this case, as it turns out, it is positive. So in both cases of interest for these three dimensional models, there is stability of perturbative stability of the vacuum, which is something which is not possible to attain in the symmetric case. Now, to be really precise, you should not let me proceed like this because I told you that this thing is positive, but in order to believe what I told you, one has to supplement this problem with boundary conditions, which is something that I will return to. But before doing that, I will show you something that is potentially even more interesting, an instability. That's why I changed my title to stress this point. As I told you, there is another incarnation of these solutions. And the incarnation has to do with this fast exponentially driven expansion with a climbing scalar. Now, to make a long story short, what happens is that, again, you can look at different sectors of perturbations. Scalar perturbations behave well. Tensor perturbations now evolve in a very peculiar way. Now, notice that in the cosmological evolution, it's not an issue of mass squared. The issue of stability is to set the perturbation to switch on a perturbation in the system and see how it evolves during the cosmological evolution. Now you can see immediately what happens, that there is one term here. The region of interest is large values of eta, which corresponds to the growing phase for the scalar. The perturbations with k different from zero, which means in homogeneous perturbations are damped, because Bessel functions are damped when the argument is large. At least they are bounded. No? What happens is, on the other hand, is the perturbations with k equals zero, they grow. They grow logarithmic, but they grow. So in other words, in this system, there is something that is probably even more interesting as a clue, given our incomplete access to the actual equations, which is an instability of isotropy. Now, it's very natural to speculate that the instability of isotropy could be pointing toward a dynamical original compactification, if you want, compactification by chance. Now let me move to the other point. Beyond this, we have been studying more general types of solutions. What are these more general types of solutions? They are, if you want, they are anisotropic solutions, or if you want, if these internal variables y are periodically identified, they are compactifications that put together a torus, internal space, an interval, and the Minkowski spacetime. Notice that I'm always insisting on this because we got this problem with the symmetric ADS type solutions. And also because, let's not forget it, after all, Minkowski four-dimensional backgrounds remain the most interesting options for us to connect, try and connect to particle physics. Now, what happens? In this case, you can have a strong coupling at one or both ends in the presence of tuples, as I will show you now. It's unavoidable in the presence of this tuple potential. But you can also consider compactification with fluxes which behave much better. Of course, they will not be compactifications of the three theories of interest. They will be symmetry breaking compactifications, say, of type 2b, for example. Now, in cosmology, there is something interesting if you allow this more general type of solution. You can have solutions in which the dilaton is bounded. The green curve is the string coupling. You see, it reaches a maximum, and also here, and the blue curve is the size of the internal dimensions. So the internal dimensions can make a bounce, or if gamma is large enough, you can have solutions where space-time expands and the internal dimensions contract. So you would have a dynamical compactification. And now this is what I want. This is the most general solution that we managed to build, because the equations are very complicated. And yet, in a special case, they admit the general solution, which has a lot to tell. And what is telling us, you can see it essentially from the exponents. You see that the exponent, there is a term proportional to t. Remember that t was accompanying our tuple potentials. And this contribution here is a Gaussian. For instance, look at the string coupling. This clearly will always win with respect to the others. Even clearly with respect to the denominator, which has to do with the flux, and also with the other term, which has to do with the flux, also modulo a choice of sign for chi. So in other words, asymptotically, the tuple always dominates. So asymptotically, no matter what fluxes you turn on, you will always end up in a situation which is universally dominated by the Das-Murad type set. But let's see, suppose now that we want to describe the boundary conditions. Let me turn to this other problem. So I told you that our tool essentially to study stability, and shortly I will address stability in this more complicated setting, has to do with giving proper boundary conditions. So I'll flash quickly on this first slide, which elaborates on minor modifications of what we are very familiar with, which means variations of matter actions in the presence of torsion, corresponding Bianchi identities for this quantity here, and this quantity here, which is the non-symmetric energy momentum tensor. And with a slight step forward, the definition of Noether currents. Notice that Noether currents are defined in this fashion, and satisfy, if you allow me to go back slightly here, satisfy a conservation equation of this type, which contains this torsion term. This will be always accompanying the covariant divergences. It is a subtlety that torsion brings along. But lo and behold, what happens is that in order to have to preserve some symmetry of the background in the presence of intervals, when you study perturbations, you have to impose that the radial component of the currents corresponding to the symmetries that are to be preserved. And for a background of this type, we are talking about translations in space-time, Lorentz rotations in space-time, and translations in the internal torus. So we're talking about infinitesimal transformations, and therefore the periodicity of the internal torus is not relevant. So lo and behold, what you have to impose is these conditions on the energy momentum tensor and this condition on the Y tensor. Now, the latter condition is very important for Fermi fields whose kinetic terms can make function in this context by, if you want, a higher dimensional generalization of what you know from the Neve-Schwarz-Ramond string. One has to invent a matrix lambda, which squares to one and anti-commutes with gamma zero, gamma r. This solves this problem, and if we have to solve the other problem, then there's an extra condition that lambda should commute with gamma mu. Then if the spinors have some extra condition, like being Majorana or Weyl or Majorana-Weyl, then for the Weyl condition, lambda should commute with the chirality matrix, and for Majorana spinors, it should be subject to this condition. Now, if you apply this algorithm, you rediscover the D equal 11 prescription of Horan-Witten, where lambda was gamma 10, the D equal 10 prescription of Polchinski and Witten, which we're starting from a non-chiral theory. But from a chiral theory, you have problems because you have restrictions. And for instance, in type 2b, you can manage to preserve all space-time symmetries only if you go down by a few dimensions. And in our case, in particular, we are considering a compactification to four dimensions where all these conditions are satisfied with a suitable choice of lambda, which I may have shown in the next page, but I don't remember. And I have to get close to the end. Now, the background that we studied in detail is the following, in the sense that we studied perturbations in this background. Now, why is this background interesting? It's interesting because in this case, the form at stake is the self-dual phi form of type 2b. The self-dual phi form of type 2b does not couple to the dilaton, as is well known from the standard setup of the ADS-CFT correspondence. And now this is the lambda I was talking to you about, by the way. Sigma 2 mixes the two gravity. So in other words, by construction, in this vacuum, the strong coupling problem for the dilaton is eliminated. Now, the question is to see whether you get stability, at what price you do, and also simply work with a system that is this as complicated as this, because to get to ask properly the questions about stability, you have to go a long way. To give you just a flavor of the difficulty, these are the way the tensor equation looks after you decompose the various excitations in terms of four-dimensional fields representations, and also when you once you fix the gauge to a partial. Incidentally, the gauge must be fixed conveniently, not in terms of Lorentz-like conditions, because the equations are first order, but in terms of a light cone or a radial type gauge, which eliminates some radial components of the self of the four form of time. So this is already very complicated. The gravity equations, I will not show them to you because they're even more complicated. But I want to convey, in concluding this talk, the general message. The general message is that if we look at the modes of the system, for k equals zero, so without Kaluza-Klein excitations on the torus, the mode, everything is fine. There's no instabilities. But as soon as you turn on Kaluza-Klein excitations, the phenomenon that we already saw at work in the ADS cross-S context pops up. So there are mixings. So you have to diagonalize some Schrödinger-like operators. And as I told you, to get here is already an art, if you want. But once you get to this form, you see immediately that the diagonal operator is precisely of this A dagger A form I showed you, plus even something which is a positive function. So if there were no mixing off diagonally, there would be no question of on the spectrum. So this operator, you see, is determining the mass eigenvalues. However, there are these off-diagonal terms which appear in a sigma one type manner, and sigma one is plus or minus one eigenvalues. So this can give you trouble, and specifically trouble at low values, okay, because at large values, okay, this term wins. Now, how do you analyze a system like this? It's very complicated, but we have an extraordinarily powerful tool from quantum mechanics, which is the variational method. Any test function, and now we know how to give boundary conditions properly, that satisfies the boundary condition will give you an excess estimate of the ground state. And this can be very precise. Now, what happens? This is the expected phenomenon. You see, you have this in this particular example, the spectrum starts linearly, then it becomes corrected by the quadratic term, but there is a tachyonic range. However, what is the big difference between this setup and the ADS process? That there is no correlation between four-dimensional scales and the antenna space. Here, in this example, as it turns out, provided you take the torus two orders of magnitude smaller than this dynamical length of the L into the radial interval, there's no action whatsoever. The theory is completely perturbed by this state. And this happens in all sectors. I showed you one, but it happens in all sectors. And there's no contradiction in doing this insofar as this length L, which sets the scale of supersymmetry breaking, in the sense that it's 1 over L, the scale, is a few orders of magnitude below the Planck scale, or rather above in terms of lengths, because the torus should be above that, otherwise it's not reliable what we do there, and so much more the other direction. But a few orders of magnitude below the Planck scale, you have no problem. So let me summarize and give you an outlook. So we are on time, more or less. So the new input is to look carefully at some compactifications that end up in Minkowski space. That I remind you, they are naturally the target of main target of our attention. No perturbative instabilities can be achieved by playing on the internal size, which is impossible in the ADS process context. The leading tadpole potential inevitably leads to strong coupling. Now the question, can you avoid strong coupling? Well, first of all, I should tell you something else. One cannot avoid curvature singularities insofar as we could try. But of course, there is a way out. Curvature corrections in string theory, although the beginning of this analysis is not encouraging. Dudas has looked at that in the past, and it's not so clear that you can get something out of it. But now here, there is an exercise that actually, if you want, indirectly, is my main motivation for being at the Sakharov conference. Because the exercise started from a previous paper and actually from a lecture that Sasha Sorin gave me precisely in Sakharov's office, that at that time, I'm talking about 2012, 2013, used to be a visitor office at Lebedev. So we were there for an afternoon. He explained to me something about a nice class of integrable dynamical systems, which essentially are gravity scalar systems with potentials of the type that we're interested in. Now, let me conclude with this. The continuous line is the potential, is the tadpole potential that we were discussing at the beginning. This one, which is e to the 3/2 phi, if you want, in Einstein frame. Here is an example of a potential which leads to a bounded value for the string coupling. It's a bit peculiar, it's surprising, because the potential is inverted, but those of you who are used to work in instanton physics know that we're going from Minkowski to Euclidean settings, the potential gets reverted. So if you want, what happens in this case, this example is that I'm using in a different context, and this is described in this paper, the same setting that led to weak coupling cosmological expansions. However, you can be suspicious that the potential like this leads to instabilities. Now, one resorts to the usual Heydaggerian trick. Remember that we had Heydaggerian plus an addition to that. And the addition in this case is a positive function. So the spectrum of this system is positive. There is no instabilities. So here is the conclusion. Drawing from the key Dudas-Murad example, and I would say keeping in mind the old Calabi-Yau orbital setup, even with broken supersymmetry in string theory, or better, more honestly, in string-inspired supergravity, because we don't have the means to address this type of curved space questions directly in string theory, my conclusion is that it's moderately optimistic and says that there seems to be some room for stable four-dimensional Minkowski value. Any one of you who has played with this kind of problems will recognize that this is not a priori an obvious outcome. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much for a very interesting talk. So please
Let
ask.
Me stop sharing so that I can...
Please ask questions. Any questions? Any comments? Sasha Sorin, maybe you say something. Ah, so I see a raised hand, Misha. Okay.
Hi, Sasha.
I just have a very primitive question.
Let me raise the volume because I don't hear you well. Please.
Okay, Misha, the first, Sasha, second.
Yes, sure.
Misha, okay.
Can you hear me, Augusta?
Yes, I now hear you.
Well, first, nice to see you.
And nice to see you, actually. Somehow.
But you don't. No, we will.
But I saw you several times.
Yeah.
I can't even guess where you are. Let me try a guess. Are you in the data?
Yes, I mean, it's all the way the same place. Okay, so my question is about the stability that you have analyzed in terms of the Schrödinger-like equations. And there was this remarkable self-conjugate structure, a dagger. And you just claimed that it so happened that it is there. But can I explain where it comes from? Is there a good reason for this?
Well, the reason is the following, that by a sequence of steps, which is an art that I must say with all pleasure was transmitted to me by Jihad to a good extent, you have to do it on a case-by-case basis, essentially starting from the dynamical equations and putting them as close as you can to a Schrödinger-like system. You see, that the reason why I'm stressing this is that we did a one-dimensional case, and what you did essentially is that these relativistic field equations, after all these steps, turned into a non-relativistic looking system.
Yeah.
The statement is that if you have higher dimensional space-time like this, you will get into a higher dimensional Schrödinger-like system. And even though it will be very complicated to analyze that system, you will have the variational method to address questions. So I let me make a statement because I still recall it. When I was a student, the most remarkable thing that I remember from Feynman's course that I took as a student, well, that at some point he wrote down the variational principle on the blackboard. He stared at it and he was somehow elated by that. It took me some years to appreciate why, but it's a remarkable tool that in other fields is really, in statistical physics, for instance, it's enormously useful because it has to do with mean field methods. In our field, somehow it is less prominent, its role, but it's a really remarkable thing. So to answer your question, It is an art. It is so much an art that in some cases it took us months. I didn't show you this example because it's so complicated. And what happened is that at the end, in that example, you ended up with a Schrödinger-like system, but the norm was not psi dagger psi, but was psi dagger times a matrix times psi. But to find that matrix was... But at the end of the day, you have some equations which are typically first order equations, if you think about fermions. And you can combine them into the second order equations. The problem is to perform at that point a semi-trivial step of eliminating first derivatives. You can do by redefining the variable, the dependent field. And once you do that, modulo this kind of subtleties, you end up with this Heidegger system. Notice that this is the same structure that you find in theory of anomalies, which have unpaired zero modes. And also in this case, I could show you that the zero modes can be computed analytically for all these systems. It's when they exist, of course.
And Augusta, excuse me. So we exhausted our time.
Okay,
so maybe you prolong your continue your answer.
No, we can discuss later.
After the third talk, okay?
Sure.